I have seen what the scheme is. So I realize that it's fighting all of them. So that means we have to time this according to our timing, not their timing. So we come back with a simple thing. It's a simple Paul. Abdul-Malik left, man, look at all this property we got. And I was saying, like, I'm making fun of them, because see, the thing is, they're not supposed, when they go, they're supposed to take everything with them. They're not supposed to leave anything behind of value. They're not supposed to help anything of value. But we done fooled them into thinking that they gonna run everything and figurehead. That's clear. You can tell if you remember how that's on their mind 100%. I'm a figurehead and I'm acting like one. I even get to step and fetch his stuff on. Why? Because Abdul-Malik is light-skinned and curly-headed Negroes, and they believe, no matter all the stuff they done heard. They said the white man's system would work. And what happened? Everything they did backfired. Nothing worked. Why? Because we're ready for them. We didn't arrange this battle. So first thing they do is they want to get the property back. That's why everything is about property and all of that. But in reality, they had fundraisers, but I went there and I put as much money on that property and this in Oakland as they did. But the way our building was, and then the boss man, you let that nigga, he got all that property? Yeah. Okay, so that's why everything is about property. Everything is about property. That's why they're fighting the battle I wanted them to fight. That's why everybody, they took your money. Right? They're frantic. You know, Mukhtar at $100,000 somewhere around. And they give the three accounts that they turned over to him were all DC accounts. Now I have to do it open. All the numbers, those from DC. One of the main accounts was with Sovereign Bank. Then it changed to Nations Bank, right? Then it went to Bank of America right down there. Yeah, I still have that old, all of that. Okay, so I'll get to the point in a minute. This whole situation that we have right now was the work of about, 2002, 10 years, 11. It took about 11, 12 years to engineer everything. That's why I said it's perfect, it's just right. That's why all the things was on strategic management under conditions of repression. All the stuff we talk about, we're going to do, the book of coincidence, the book of what we call, what we're doing right now, what we've been doing, grand jury, all of that. We've done all of that. That's what we've done all of that. But they thought we was going to do it then. Strategic retreat, 2008. I don't know if you remember those lectures. They're just what we're doing, strategic retreat. And we're telling them what we're doing. We're telling them, look, this is the way it is. In a revolutionary battle, if you lose, would you push that up? You could just turn it off. Just push the one on the left side and turn it off. I know there's a freeze in the back. So here's where they were. Psychological guerrilla warfare. closest to us. Strategic management under conditions of repression. And strategy. If you look at all of those lectures are systematic and those articles are staged just at the right time. And all the articles are explaining what we're doing. Because we talk about guerrilla struggle, we talk about encirclement and suppression. We're talking about the exact thing that's going on and what we're living through. That was at that stage. The recent stage, let's say 2013 to, we'll call it 2017. Okay, when they cranked up, they were certain we're gonna knock that nigga. So much so that a year after that, I don't know, they was gonna try to make me paranoid, they was gonna try to make me, like when the government put a lot of pressure on a group or organization, it gets loose. I studied that in detail the first time around. The first time around back in 1970 and 71, it was a big deal. It was a big deal. The police, all of this attachments working to finish you off, then they bring the feds in. And the brothers would say, well, they got you on the chessboard now. That means you're on the white man's chessboard. That means you got to go. I'm saying myself, but I said, I'm not playing according to his rules. I ain't playing. But they paranoia is 100% for thinking. Because see, what Allah give you, when Allah got something hooked up for you, I say it all the time, Allah gonna give you what you need for that period of time. We're in a totally different period of time and environment now. We're in a world that the government don't understand. Because they've never had to deal with nobody for no 40 years. And as a Muslim, and number one, have counteracted encirclement and suppression. Have resisted every little bait. The little bait. Even the bait of success, you know what I mean? The reason we, this is about Nasr al-Ma'ina, old soul at rest, and I'll get to that. That means a soul that have went through all of the transitional stages and have reached a certain level of peace and contentment. They're satisfied, they're contented with who they are, they're contented, satisfied with the job that they've been doing. Then it says, enter into my paradise. That means these people, and Allah is well pleased with them. And that person, those people are well pleased with Allah. Everything that happens to them, they're happy about it. They use challenges. It's back to the old thing. Whatever your problem is, outgrow it. Don't worry about it. Just outgrow anything they throw at you, you outgrow it. You know, if you look back in history, the caveman, he used to have to walk around and what have you. And everything was a barrier. A mountain could be a barrier. Rivers was a barrier. People on this side of the river, was a big one, spoke a less language. People on the other side spoke another language. Why? Because of a barrier. Okay. The old caveman looked up and said, boy, if I could just fly, you know, I wouldn't have no more of these barriers. Nothing could stop me. If I could just fly like a bird. Look at the bird flies over all of this stuff. So the caveman improved, Homo erectus technocratus. He gets in a bird now, he flies over all barriers, and he looks down on it. So he had to outgrow the barriers, he had to outgrow all that. This is a simple rule, outgrow your problems. All problems is a stepping stone, not a stumbling block. Leave them one alternative, same thing with them. Cracker, you can kill us, and that's it. Finish. And you can't do that unless Allah write it down. Well, it's written, you're helpless. Okay, you gotta remember. I'll get back to the original thing, might as well continue. During the period in which we're living, we say it every week, but we have evolved to such a high level, and it was so negroid that even when you told them, they still, look, Abdul Malik made his move, it didn't work, so they're gonna come back with something that will work. When we think about Imam Jamil then, there's a talk in here when he's talking and Stokely Carmichael is having a program here in about 95. He's getting ready to go back to Africa. He's had terminal cancer. He wants to die in Africa. All Imam Jamil gave a good talk there. But strictly is Islam, you know. He's called Five Pillars of Islam. And the writer here of this introduction is amazed at the different approach from Die Nigga Die and Revolution by the Book. Okay. Remember, we always talk about the reason we use Imam Jamil so much is because he was a great evolutionary. He was a great evolutionary. That's why when he needed certain help, see, we never took Baya to Imam Jamil. And some people could figure it out why, you know. Fareed is one of them. And the snitches in Oakland took us around us. Dar sympathizers, but police. Hassan Nuruddin and those guys. Hassan Nuruddin's brothers right there now with Mukhtar. They come and they have Juma there, and they all of them live outside of town. They live like Gaithersburg, and they coming to Oakland. But it's okay, no problem. So Imam Jamil evolved from this die nigga die stuff. You know, okay. We evolve from Big Hankism. But it's a serious evolution. You can understand Imam Jamil's evolution because it sticks within a certain things he wouldn't do because of the system. So he wasn't going to trust anybody to do certain things because people broke his trust. But he would say, yeah, man, when I was overseas, they didn't have a family or wife, they didn't, people didn't help. To him, that was very tragic. Okay, the people didn't help me, but I didn't expect them to. I didn't expect them to help. When I left my crew in Oakland, I was hustling, getting ready to leave, and I went and bought them a pound of blow just to deal off, you know, the two main guys. There was a lot of blow there, you know, a pound of raw blow, just to have something to do, and I'm getting ready to leave. They could have sent me $2,000 a month. Oh, that was like a king. Don't mention $5,000. I had to have money before I left that stage and ready to come to me whenever I needed. They never helped me. I never held it against them. Why? Because that's what people do. Why do we not have any animosity to anybody? Because they're living out a Quranic principle. Right? Everybody's doing what the people in the Quran do. Right? So why can we get, how can we get mad at people when they cut your throat or something like that? Let me see, I think I got it. This is what from the Quran. There's a little bit I'd like to read here, if I can, yeah. After their appointment to leadership, the believers from here on are given such instructions and directions as are essential for training and enabling them to discharge the duties of that position of responsibility. They are first of all warned that leadership is not a bed of roses, but a bed of thorns. They will be confronted with difficulties, hardships, and trials at the very outset and will have to undergo untold sufferings and losses. But if they go through all of these ordeals with fortitude and proceed on the way of Allah, they will be blessed with countless blessings and rewards by Him, by Allah. The next footnote said, that is, fortitude and prayer will generate in you the power which is required to bear that burden of responsibility with which you have been entrusted. Fortitude will give you that patience and courage under the affliction, privation, and temptations which you are bound to encounter, and that moral strength and endurance which will be sorely needed in Allah's way, which is full of dangers. Prayer will train you in discipline and other moral qualities which are essential for the right type of leadership. In other words, this is from it's a footnote, Malam Our Duty. And it's talking about when you're given a responsibility. Okay, everybody is getting an idea that something is going on in this global. It's too clear, something's going on. But don't nobody want no real leadership? They want to quiet it down. All the brothers, our brothers, the foreigners, everybody is on a road to quiet everything down. And they mean it because they feel like they did out at Adams. If we train ourselves to defend ourselves, it'll make the white man mad. You just said that. O messenger, let not those people who are striving hard in their way of disbelief grieve you, whether they be from those who say with their mouths, we believe, but their hearts do not believe, or from among those who have become Jews, for the latter eagerly listen to lies. They spy for other people who have never had any chance of coming to you. They twist the words of Allah's book out of their context in order to distort their proper meanings. Mm. They say to the people, if you are enjoined to observe such and such teaching, accept it. If it is on the other hand this, then reject it. You could do nothing to save from Allah's punishment. a man whom Allah wills to put on trial. Such people are those whose hearts Allah does not will to purify. They are ignorant. For them, in this world, grievous punishment in the hereafter. Okay, now I fully understood this. I've understood this basically all my life from the training, the riots in prison and the little kid, that when the white man come to get you, he come to get you. And if anybody have a chance to shift the weight on you in front of power, the white man has the power to take your parole, to extend your day, to send you to camp, to make you a drag, to do anything. Most people will do that. Okay. Then you have us. Here we are, mainly by ourselves. We don't have the power to give anybody anything. And the government have the power to give power and authority and certificates to anybody it wills. And from what they see, anybody that falls in line with the system, it's big. They'll make Zayd them big, right? They'll come on that. Pretty soon he'll be the, not the father of the, but the sage, let's call it. They'll play him off.
The spiritual leader.
Spiritual sage, yeah. Right. Okay. They'll put Abdul Malik in every university, every big masjid by them. And he'll be big, according to them. It's like if they take Professor Griffin off stage and they put them clowns on there and talk about, kill that bitch, shoot them niggas, right? They got top billing, right? If they squash the poets, last poets, and put, what his name, Heron.
Gil Scott Heron.
Gil Scott Heron. But he and Abdul Malik love him. And I told him, I don't like that man. I say he took over from a time out, the revolution will be not televised. That's not his, that's the poets. And they gave him that position. You see, when we saw him at the University of California, he was so high and he asked us, y'all want to come with me and get high? So that's why he gave it to him. So he don't do nothing with it,
right? He can be down to dope fiend.
Yeah, well, of course. Big down dope fiend. Okay, now, here we are. You can't offer nobody nothing but what? We're some church, blood, sweat, and tears. You get with that nigga, you're going on the uphill road for sure. Right? And we can't offer you nothing. Anything we offer you, they take it away in 2 minutes. They take it away. They'll scare your mama, they'll scare your children, they'll scare everybody. And if they lock in on you, they're gonna lock in on everybody around you. And if you're the target, that means that we're gonna use all of our skill, ingenuity. So you got the local government. If you got a woman on welfare, they said, oh my God, with our cooperation, I think your welfare has been overextended. Aren't you, haven't you been on 12, 13 years? Yeah? Well, you know the new welfare program say after 5 years, you got a good job. Job? What? Okay. Yeah, we got it, okay. And then you have a police type like Mukhtar, who believes in the system. They don't believe in itself. You remember when they was here for the meeting? All the educated Negroes was given like education as a big thing, and they was telling Mukhtar now in Khadijah, and they said, we're going to upgrade our education. He did, he went to community college. He was not a bookie type person, so he couldn't do most of that stuff. So they went and took some courses, but that's what they told him. Abdul Malik and Mukhtar was all together, and I'm telling Abdul Malik, I'm trying to help him with his problem. So Mukhtar called me, he's sitting right there. He said, well, we would encourage him to go. I said, you don't need to go to school. That's all you gotta do is pay attention to what I'm telling him. You go into fundamental management now, Pat, not to worry about anything. That, you know, you can manage it. And what I was telling him was, in school, they're gonna teach you management, but ask the people that come out of school how much management they know. We're gonna teach you real management. You learn this, you'll be able to go anywhere in the world and survive and thrive. Okay. Imam Jamil was a he was not like those guys at the time. But in the 60s, what they did was what they tried to do to us later. When they want to get rid of you, they give you a big reputation. Oh, this big nigga here. Like when I came here, Rayful Edmonds was such a big nigga in my brother. He's getting dope from that, the Negroes in L.A. So if the Negroes in L.A. not big, he sure can't be big. Right? So, Imam Jamil came under that crew of newspaper blacks. They make you famous in the newspaper and stuff like that. But that don't mean you had a game to go with it. See, if you had the game to go with it, anywhere in the world, you go, oh, there's some money here. You figure out how to make a living. You know, I hustled where I was, too, just for the heck of it, just so I didn't, just to get the feel of how to, you know. Okay, so if you're in Tanzania, you go to the bank and change your money, it's 7 shillings. So if you got a $100 bill, they give you 700 shillings back. On the big black market, you could get, let's say 21, you could get just a few more. That's 3 times, because the Indians and other people's got big money. They want to put their money in American money. Okay. So I can just deal in cash. I can tell any American or European to come to the big hotel, gonna change a little money on them. Yeah, I was thinking about changing $100. So what they gonna give you in the bank? 700. I said, sure, that'll be like you $1,000 right now, $1,000 shillings. And then he got 300 extra. Okay, I take that $100 bill out and got 21. See, I gave him 10. He's getting a deal. And if it's a Negro or brother, man, shoot, I gave you 14. Double your money. You got $100 bill coming out of the big fro. I'm going to visit all the African spots. That's the man you want to get by that price. So I'm giving him almost a dealer price, a medium dealer price. Because a medium dealer might get 14, but I'm saying to him, you give me that $100 bill there, I'm going to give you 1,400 shillings. That's 700 extra. Double your money. It's a hustle. Because they don't have access to the Americans. I'm an American. I could stay in a big hotel, same one, New Africa Hotel. I could stay in a hotel. I hang around the hotel. I know where all the Americans coming in, all the British. Oh my goodness, you're gonna change. Well, let me help you. That's what I do. I'm a helper here. I help. I'm a tourist helper, and I'm aid. I mean, want you to enjoy it. Where you want to go visit, all this good. When you go up there, go see Mr. So-and-so. Why didn't Imam Jamil do that? It's simple. If He had $100, all he got to do is change $100. If he didn't get a good deal, maybe he got 18. Maybe he couldn't get the 14. So, a 15, okay? So he get a guy, you want to change, you want to send him, he'll give you $1,000. So after he can change $400, $500, boy, he had his money. He had his money. After a couple of months, you're Tanzanian rich. Tanzanian rich. But he wasn't, the books are key, the books are key. Here's the point I'm making. Abdul Malik and them, Mukhtar and them kind of thought that I was like the bookish niggas they read about. They underestimated, and they took the picture of me that the government made, gave. Bahia would do it as she was telling, you know, maybe you beat your wife, or something like that. I never could tell them stuff nobody did, you know what I mean? Lucky to have a head on straight, you know what I mean? But I didn't hold it against them because the government, here's what I'm trying to say. I don't hold people's behavior because people are not built to fight governments. I was. The government built it. So they did it. Okay, and then we got hooked up with Quran and Hadith. Okay, now I'll get into our talk. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Atadiyu min la yasalukum ajran wa hum muhtadun. Obey those who ask no reward of you for themselves and who have themselves received guidance. I don't want to sound arrogant in what I'm getting ready to say, but I have to try to explain where I think we are. This is the reason I started with this ayat right here. To the righteous soul will be said, O thou soul, in complete rest and satisfaction, come back thou to thy Lord, well pleased thyself and well pleasing unto him. Enter thou then among my devotees, enter thou my heaven. My view about all this is talking about nafs al-mutmain, not nafs amar, the animal self-suffering. Not nafs dawam.